you on. But I don't know where we're going, but if I say anything you don't agree with, it's just we have a different opinion, right? Start with DNA. The mic stand. Our DNA. Descendants and ancestors. We are the descendants, we are the ancestors. Our DNA, each and every one of us, is made up of the elements of the earth. We are the metals, the minerals, and the liquids of the earth. Each and every one of us. We're just different shapes. We be the cannabis, the trees, it doesn't matter. We're just all, we all have the earth's DNA. So in reality, any relationship to power that we would truly have as human physical matter is in our relationship to the earth, because that's the source of our life. And because of our DNA, being the children of earth, we all come from tribes. In our genetic memories, and we all have genetic memories, in our genetic memories, the information is there. In our civilized awareness, we don't know about, we don't understand. But anyway, we are all the descendants of tribes. So one time in our common ancestry as descent, as tribes, we all lived in a spiritual perception of reality. And the spiritual perception of reality was really about responsibility. It wasn't about anything else, it was about responsibility. And as a part of our spiritual perception of life, because we were the children of the earth, we were made up of the earth, and the earth was our mother. And as a part of our responsibility, spirituality, we were to maintain as harmonious a relationship with the earth as we possibly could, as generations. And that's the way it was. And then at some point, there appeared this idea of God, gods. And the idea of God, gods, religion, had built into its perception that there was a greater entity, God, than earth and spirit. And that this greater entity was removed from the earth. This male dominator God, because this is what was emerging, a male dominator God removed from the planet, then brought in the idea that the earth was the dominion of man. And in our common tribal ancestry, every one of our ancestors resisted this perception of reality.
John,
why don't you ask him?
Yeah,
you would
be quiet.
They don't bother me. So there emerged these two perceptions, what I'll call a religious perception, and what I call a spiritual perception. And the process of civilization is to erase our memories to our past, to erase the memories, to sever any ancestral linkage, consciousness that we would have with our past. As human beings, human physical beings, spirit, a part of our relationship to power is connected in our spiritual relationship to the past, because we are the descendants, the ancestors, and power. When it was a spiritual perception of reality, we understood what power was, but now it's a religious perception of reality, and there is a great misunderstanding about power.
Who's talking over there? Shut up! Hey!
Fill in council!
Take your conversations outside.
Agree. Power and authority.
People.
Power and authority.
Respect.
Power and authority.
Not politics.
Power and authority.
People.
Power and authority are two separate realities. Completely separate realities. But we have been conditioned to be confused about that. Authority is authority. Whoever makes the most money can get authority, not power, authority. Whoever produces the most means of violence, the weapons of war, they can get authority, but not power. But we have been conditioned to thinking that these things represent power, and therefore we never identify ourselves in relationship to power. We identify these other things that most of us that are unattainable to control the money and the guns. DNA. And everyone has some kind of an understanding of what happened to the Indians. See, it's like when Columbus went to America. In reality, it was all about disease. The carrier of the disease happened to be a human being, the form of a man, the form of a people. But it was a disease. It was a diseased perception of reality. It's almost like a diseased spirit that affected the perception of reality of the human beings that carried the disease. Like when Columbus came out of Europe and went to the Americas, Europe was in the 400th year of a 500-year Inquisition. Now the Inquisition had to do with the fighting of the descendants of the tribes of Europe, subduing the descendants of the tribes of Europe. And this is the Inquisition, 1200, 1300 something, in that time period. But at that time, they were still fighting the descendants of the tribes of Europe, because the descendants of the tribes of Europe, the serfs and the peasants, they still followed many of their old ancestral ways. They prayed many ways. They followed many of the rituals and the ceremonies, but the church was religion. The church was establishing authority, establishing itself as the authority of God on the earth, and that man, the people, had to be subservient to God by submitting to this authority created as church. So this tremendous war raged through Europe, but they call it the Inquisition. Like now, they didn't call it war, they called it some other kind of political thing going on. But it was a war being waged. So by the time Columbus got to the Americas, Europe, the descendants of tribes of Europe had been through 20 generations, 20 years to a generation, had been through 20 generations of this. Now the Inquisition, basically, if you disagreed with the church, you were guilty of heresy, and if you were accused of this, you were guilty. And you had to be tortured. And you had to be killed. And the church had to take all your property. See, so by the time, and see, and this was when a lot of, they got really carried away with the burning of the women as witches, because see, all this had to do with severing that, fucking with the genetic memory. It had to do with breaking all those tribal ways and those ancestral ways. See, because in reality, before there could be a dominator God who the world must fall subservient to, then the whole world must turn against the earth. Because the earth, before, the earth was the mother and the whole world was with the earth. So all of those who are with the earth, they will always be the enemy in some kind of a way of this dominator God, because our relationship to the earth establishes our power, and they understand that more than we understand it. See, because we still confuse ourselves by mistaking authority as power. Sometimes you got to submit to the authority because it's there and you don't really have a choice at that time. But that doesn't make it power, that makes it authority. Power is something entirely different. Our DNA, we are of the earth. We understand how they can take and mine old dinosaurs, take old dinosaurs out of the ground, turn it through a refining process, turn it into fuel to run the machine, the electrical machine world that we're in. But remember, our DNA, we are a part of the earth. So maybe we're just another natural resource being mined the same way. See, maybe the being part of us, human being, human physical being, spirit, energy, maybe the being part of us is being mined through the human part of us by the indoctrination that is programmed into us to view reality with limited perceptions. Because it's like, because with the things that are going on in the world that we are in today, it's almost like we have a responsibility to define reality ourselves. It's like, to me, you see, we've been programmed to not be in synchronization with ourselves. It's like to be lost from who we really are. See, so the way we're programmed to be lost against who we are, it's like all the confusions, whatever it is, the fears, the doubts, whatever the roles, the images, all the things that we have to project. See, we have to project these things, and we have to believe in these things we project at times. But it's like, we know when they mine the resources out of the ground and the pollution and the way that it affects the environment. We call it pollution. But when we look within our own individual realities, see, all the doubts and the insecurities and the things about ourselves that we just don't trust, that have all the negative light, this is the pollution left over from mining our spirit through our logic. See, and I want to go about this idea of freedom. Because I have a real problem. I mean, I embraced the word for a long time. And in some way, I mean, I still look at it, but I look at it differently now because I don't know what it means. See, I don't know what it means. And in some kind of a way, it's got something to do with this whole religious perception of reality, the spiritually enslaved. The spiritually enslaved, the spiritually fed upon, they need freedom. But freedom has no meaning. It has no meaning. It's an abstraction, and therefore we never get anywhere. To me, it's like it's about responsibility. To be free means something than freedom. To be free. But I look at it as responsibility. Whatever our struggles are and whatever it is we participate in, it's got something to do with us fulfilling our responsibilities. It's not about freedom. Those who hate under the abstraction of freedom, it's like a heroin for the thought process to kind of just help people deflect the whole reality of responsibility by chasing the abstraction of freedom. And it keeps everyone in perpetual conflict over ideas, over so many things. In reality, it's about responsibility. And we have to understand that the language that... See, English is the language that's getting imposed more and more throughout the world. We have to understand that the language that we speak, we really need to understand it, because the words have a meaning, and sometimes the people use the words in ways they don't understand what the meanings mean. They use them out of ways of convenience. To believe, like say, I have a problem with that, to believe. I tried to believe, but there was a lie in the middle. B-E-L-I-E-V-E. What's the matter with think? I think. But to me, sometimes I think we use believe as a way to avoid thinking. It's just convenient. I believe. I don't know why, I just believe. I think. Because a part of that energy, that power, that our DNA, who we really are, and our relationship to power, it manifests itself through our thinking process. Our ability to create with our minds. See, but it's been tapped into. We've been just turned into a colossal energy pool and been tapped into, and something else feeds off of it. So it's about our thinking. Because the struggles that Canada faces yet in the industrialized society, those struggles are many and they're real. But there will be many, many struggles going on simultaneously. This is just one of the ways that it takes place. But we were put in this situation that we're in through an evolved process. The only way out of the situation is through an evolved process. But how clearly we use our intelligence, how clearly we use our minds, as coherently as we possibly can, as often as we can, this will influence how much time it's going to take to evolve through this. And it is about evolution. But that's why we're here. There is a reason we're here at the time that we're here. There is a reason we are here under these circumstances. It's to fulfill our responsibilities. Because we can talk about spirit, you know, when we be spirit. But there is responsibility that goes with it. Religion is about the abstraction of freedom. Spirit is about the responsibility and our right to be responsible. That was our gift, the right to be responsible. So I'm going to get out of this in a minute. But I think about defining our own reality. We should never lie to ourselves. We should always tell ourselves the truth. And I'm talking about, and the most dangerous lies are the ones of rationalization and justification. We should always tell ourselves the truth. Define our own reality. And if know who we are, and if we don't always like all of our truths, well, that's just the way that it is. That's a part of us. That's not the total or the sum. It's a part. And if we don't like it enough, then maybe we will evolve away from those things that are truths we don't like. But we should always tell ourselves the truth. We should not lie to ourselves. Establish and define our own reality. You know, and there's a new world order headed. See, you're the Indians now. You are. See, they took what we had. They took what we had. Somebody else got it, and now they're going to take it from somebody else. That's the way that it works. See, so they had intense designs for the human population in this new world order, and now they're going to govern this planet in the 21st century. So our minds are very valuable, because that is the disease that Columbus brought to our land. See, there was no defense, no antibiotic to it. Never had this disease before. But in 500 years, see, an antibiotic evolves, don't an understanding evolves, but it's how we use our minds. We have to outthink them in the course of this evolution. It's not outreact, but outthink. And I want, see, in a personal, see, I think there's times, see, about the cannabis. In our ancestral times, in our ancestry, all of our ancestors, they had medicines that they used from the natural world that were their medicine. For some it was stones, for some it was this, for some of that, for some of that it was cannabis. So it's like, in a way, it's like it's a tribal thing that civilization cannot repress. The thing must live, it must go on. There's certain tribal behaviors that must go on. They just change shape and change form. So we're just continuing we're a part of a continuation of a thing that is as eternal as time and people. See, and somewhere in there, if we look at it, we have a relationship to power in that relationship also. But anyway, it's how we use our mind. I thank you for your attention.
Yeah, it's such a good party. I've got two kinds of weed here. I think they've both been nominated. The White Rhino and the Northern Light 5 A's Mist.
You always want to try to take a microphone when somebody's passing out joints. It's important for us to heal our extinctionistic tendencies as a society and look to nature for our masters in designing the perfect economic system, because for God's sakes, it seems to be what is screwing us up is our economy, which is based on toxic, unevenly distributed, finite resources that have a purpose in being where they are in the larger scheme of things. And by rupturing the oil lines of the brakes of this moving world, we are certainly creating something for our children and grandchildren that is unacceptable. And I've always wondered what excuse I would give our kids and our grandkids when they grow up and they start looking back on history and ask us why we continue to burn petrochemicals in our automobiles when we knew we could run them on hemp.
I love everybody in here. You know, it looks like I hear a lot of people out here with very beautiful messages and a lot of really nice things to say. And I just don't want people to forget that it's not us and them. You know, it's all us. We're just like one thing out here. We're all together. Even the people who are thinking wrong and acting wrong out of their own, like, ignorance or whatever, they're all beautiful. And, like, we don't have any enemies. We just have people who are doing wrong, and we gotta show them the way. And I don't know, you know, y'all just thank you. That's all I gotta say.
The women, first of all, they've grown some of the best herb I've ever smoked in my life. They got something special they put in, like, I don't know what it is. Some energy they have on it, some connection they have with it, whatever it is. They've got a touch that I've very rarely seen any men be able to reproduce. And about things that John Trudell said and others, connections that we've lost as a race of people, whites in general. The way the Indians used to, the way the Indians believe in seven generations and thinking in terms of the future and looking ahead and being farsighted, not so short-sighted the way most of our generation has been taught to be. But I see, I feel, I know that we as a people are, as a generation, are breaking away from those traditional programmings or poisonings or diseases. And I know that we're getting better. And we're one of the first generations that has taken the time to question reality and authority, you know. It was all last minute I took the chance to come here. It wasn't planned. I ran up to Seattle the day before I got on my flight to get my passport, you know. And it was all literally grace of God. The day before I was there, there was a snowstorm, and I got up to the passport office. It said, sorry, this office will be closed at 1 p.m. on the 19th. And I was there on the 20th. My flight was on the 21st. You know. I know I'm here. Literally, divine intervention has brought me here. That's all that boils down. That's the only thing that separates us from the animals. The animals don't have the freedom of will we do to fuck up or to make things better. That's all it is. We make the choices every fucking moment, every beautiful moment. We make it heaven or hell every instant. It's our choices. And no one makes them for us. No one tells us how to do it. They try to, but we don't have to listen to them if we don't want to. I've been resisting what they've been telling me for years. I know. We don't have to listen.
Damn the man.
And I heard that we all do our, you know, we have an emotional response to everything we do. Like, people drink alcohol to relieve depression. I hear we smoke herb to relieve sadness. And I can see, for me, it's true. Seen it. Hey. Walking down the street smoking herb. You know, not being afraid of getting busted for it. That's a beautiful thing. Being able to go into a coffee shop, that's an interesting name for it, but, and being able to buy herb legally, that's pretty tolerant. And I salute, you know, I really applaud the Amsterdamians, the Hollanders for their tolerant atmosphere here in Holland, which tolerates the herb and hash, I think, personally, mostly out of economic reasons, ulterior motives, let's just say. Not necessarily because they think it's a good thing to have around, or that they would do it, or that they think it's a medicinal plant, or they look at it like it's the healing of all nations, like the bush doctors in Jamaica would call it. The thing that brings people together from all walks of life. From all, you know, I think they have ulterior motives as to why they really want it, or they allow it legal, you know, and the money part of it is a big portion. So, you know, I'm here about medicine. And why is that medicinal extract of those flowers considered illegal? The very same identical, unchanged, unaltered, unadulterated form which everyone has used every time they smoked or ingested the herb or the hash. There's nothing there in that oil that wasn't there in the first place, in the bud. You know? It didn't get changed. There's no presto magic, you know, to the whole process.
America, called Madrid, New Mexico. Near Santa Fe, New Mexico, for some of you know that area. We have been growing marijuana since the 60s, very strong and very liberated. We have one of the only counties in America where it is a law that the head of the household has to have a gun on his presence. We have a county which the FBI, the federal government, will not walk into.
All right. Woo-hoo!
And speaking about women and marijuana, my mom was arrested on my graduation day. She threw a party for me, and someone had narked her out, and she was arrested with 46 planks and given a year of probation, 178 hours of community service, $400 worth of fines, 7 days in jail, which a lady who is a healer, she is a medicinal lady, her whole life she has become a masseuse and has become someone of very powerful will, was arrested and put into jail because she had 46 small little plants growing in her backyard. Natural herbal remedies such as the ayahuasca and mushrooms and stuff in a very healing, very powerful way. And there's many, many powerful uses for herbs that America has not gone into. There are shamans that are speaking all over in universities in Peru and places like this. And there's this stuff coming to America. There's this knowledge coming. And people need to open up to it and let themselves know. People in Europe need to open up to what there is happening in our Peruvian rainforests. And our rainforests are being depleted yearly, by the way. They're dying. This herb, this medicine, which is more powerful than any marijuana, than any hit you will ever take, is being destroyed because people want to wear Nike shoes, Reebok, they want to have McDonald's, they want to be American culture. We are killing our rainforest because of our ideals, because of our ideal how we want to live, about everything that we want to be. We are enforcing this on other countries, and they are killing their own countries to be like us. And this is very powerful. The ayahuasca arrows are chasing out the cocaine. They're chasing this stuff out of South America. They're trying to do this so that it will stop the American influence. We are harming others. We need to change our ideal in America. That is where it starts. We are one of the most powerful countries as far as influence goes. And we need to change our ideals. We need to vote green. We need to vote for the earth. The ideal of growing. The ideal of growing in ourselves. The ideal of our earth growing.
Commercial food everywhere across America is like made to look bigger, richer, sweeter, nicer. The farmers are all told this is going to give you more yields, it's disease resistant. These are produced in the government labs, they're hybrids. They'll do better for you, you'll have less waste, more profit. Because slowly but surely everyone is getting less and less of what they really need with those foods. It's only with the organically grown old heirloom strains that people get a full blend, a full complement of their essential amino acids. And it's also all those commercial foods, they're all chemically fertilized. They're all pesticided, everything else. All those chemicals are all owned by the government. They're all owned by the big business, which is perpetuating the whole thing to begin with. They want the people weak. It's the oldest of Roman schemes. Keep the people weak and diseased. They're easier to control, divide and conquer.
and maybe give some inspiration to people. And we all know plenty well about Solid the Planet, and you know, it's up to the people who have open minds like us to fucking fix it. Because everyone that just doesn't give a shit, you know, they're just gonna keep on going to McDonald's and fucking woofing down all that crap. And you know, pretty soon after genetics, after we have so many fucking babies, they're not gonna be able to think because mom's taking them to the fucking McDonald's, you know, and feeding them full of crap. So it starts with the kids, really. And you teach them right, and fucking all the dads play their part. You know, we'll really fucking get this planet rocking and evolve to where we're supposed to be. just a little nervous here. When I went home last year from the Cup, I had lots of inspiration and motivation, especially from people like Michael Moran pumping me full of energy. And what happened, we got here is like Arizona, kinda. I think it's the first actual government sales tax number in Canada to sell dried marijuana flowers. And when I got that, it was pretty cool. But the only problem was is that they said that they couldn't tell the cops not to arrest me, which was kind of the bad part of it. But I didn't really listen to that, and thank God to the nice people at HempBC let me sell big fat nugs out front there for $10 a gram Canadian. And after about 3 weeks, the cops didn't like it, so they came and they arrested me. And the next day, I went out and got a pager in a bogus name and started selling right in front of the store again. And that was pretty cool. But really, really what I want to say is that if everyone goes home with a lot of fucking energy, you know, write a letter to the government about why you use pot, write your fucking congressman, you know, if everyone just does something or gets together with someone else, the chain reaction will happen and fucking shit will start going for the good. Peace. This evil fucking pipe that we can all smoke them in that actually is made with hemp. Somehow or some way is hemp stone, it's got hemp oil in it. And I hope you guys like it. Thanks.
Hearing no objections, everybody take a deep breath through the nose and out the nose. Couple, three, and right out the sound. You'll roll along if you've never done this before. Some voices are stronger the first two times, and some finally get the feel of it, and then suddenly everybody's hair feels good about it. And lots of action tonight. Don't forget 420 tomorrow. Get more people here.
Circles, traditionally and informally, help us push our energy center.
Okay.
Light is returning, even though this is the darkest hour, no one can hold back the dawn.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good.
I'd like to share something that one of my ancestors, though still alive, still where I come from. I would be very honored to share this with you. I am tired of being romanticized. Your emptiness attempts to devour me. Mind and heart and soul. I run, as canny as a fox, sit in wide open spaces, hidden only by the shadow of a cottonwood leaf. Harried, hurried, you pass me by, searching hidden valleys, secluded caves, for bits of you you think you'll find in me. I am the strength of the nations. In my sacred womb, I hold the beginning and the end. The fires of life and death are at the center of my soul. The winds and waters of time flow out of my being.
Hello. My name is Marty Pinnacus. I'm a Ute Apache from Colorado. And we'd like to share some music with you. It's a flute song. The gentleman that's going to play it for you, he's a Comanche from Oklahoma. His name is Gahu. He's from North Carolina. And the other singer that's going to be on the side, his name's Al, Gold Eagle. He's from New York. And hope you enjoy the music.
Thank you. Hey, welcome to my brothers back here with these beautiful songs of our people, our culture, our grandmas, our grandpas. Something that sometimes we lose that connection with the earth. We lose that connection with the water and the air that we breathe. We just take it for granted. We assume it's always going to be there, but yet we walk the earth with throwing things here and there and polluting the water. And it's good sometimes that you fast with water for about a day and see what it tastes like to you at the end of the day. Maybe you'll understand somewhat how sacred it is. And some of us also forget how sacred we all are. How much energy we have. That we have a lot of energy, but sometimes that light goes out. Sometimes we don't know how to treat each other. We lose our balance. I've seen a lot of love shared here. It's really inspiring to be here in the world and know that there's people can act like they're related. I want to say thank you for all responsible people for putting all this energy into the Cannabis Cup 1996. Good luck to all your relatives out there that participated in growing these plants and also for the ones that participated in testing them. And it was an honor to do that also. I don't think I tasted anything that wasn't any good. Like I say, it's hard to make a decision. We'll try to, in the best way that we know how, in a fair way. Thank you. Mitakuyasa.
We're two, probably three. But, you know, we share it all with you. Thank you. Thank you.
morning, stand up for your rights. In the night, get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. Get up, stand up. Come on, stand up for your rights. No, we won't give up the fight. No, we won't give up the fight. No, we won't give up the fight. No, we won't give up the fight.
Respect every time Jack Heron, for real. Go there, jump in, my driver.
Smoked enough marijuana? No, as they rip into these bags, just being, oh man, I didn't get enough. Yeah, did you try this one? Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, that's better. Whoa, give me that one. Yeah, we're all having a nice stone time, aren't we? Yeah. Yeah, all of you all checking out all the different coffee shops? You know, you going to the Anne Frank coffee shop yet? Yeah. It's kind of hard to find people there. It's a pretty empty coffee shop most of the time. There's a couple of big guys in black uniforms at the outdoor. Have you been trying the different samples and really, you know, enjoying Dutch marijuana? Yeah? All right, well, if you think it's good, if you think it's... For the Europeans, we'll start with the Europeans. If you think the pot is good, for all you Europeans here. I want to find out how many kind of European people are here. If you think the pot is good here, let's hear from the Europeans. Is the pot good in Amsterdam?
Yeah!
Oh, yes. Do you think the pot is good in Amsterdam? You got enough things to do during the day. I mean, you only got about 20 coffee shops to run around to. The Hemp Expo booth. Did you check out the Hemp Expo booth? Pretty nice, huh? Yeah, you know, I mean, 3 years ago I came to the Cannabis Cup and I saw my first Hemp Expo booth and I thought, hey, that looks really good. A big bag with holes in it, you know, it's got a certain kind of look to it. And I decided, oh, you're giving me a little background music. So I went around and I took a look at some of the different things that they had and I was amazed because they had all sorts of things. You get a chair made out of hemp. You get a bed made out of hemp. You get clothes made out of hemp. You can get condoms made out of hemp. You know, it's the longest fiber, the strongest fiber. You know, lasts forever. You can get everything here, can't you? Yeah. It's a smoking time. Everyone's like this. Huh? Oh, yeah, that's funny. Yeah, that's good. Yeah. Oh, what's that? Oh, you know, the attention span at the Cannabis Cup goes from joint to joint. Someone's talking to you. Blah, 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 blah. Oh, yeah, give me that. Oh. Yeah, okay. Blah, blah, blah. Oh, yeah, give me that. Whoa. What's that? I need to know. Your mind is working really good when you want to find out which strain it is. Where are you from? There. No, I was there just a few minutes ago. But now I'm here. Yeah. And, you know, it's very funny because, in the United States, now they're making it almost impossible to smoke cigarettes. And I'm not saying that, you know, you should be allowed to smoke cigarettes anywhere. You should, you know, be hauled off to jail because they haul your ass off to jail if you're smoking pot. But in Europe, slowly the wheels have been turning. You know, the Holland has led the charge. But you go to a lot of the other places in Europe. You go to Germany. Germany. They're hitting the pack, too. You know, they're jumping forward. They've got a lot of hemp stuff growing. They've got many different things. They've got cups, they've got plastics, they've got clothing that's looking a little more stylized than the old rucksack versions you can see in some of the hemp booths. But you go back to the United States and you got all the smokers, but you don't have any of the pot. You know, I mean, you do, right? I mean, here at the Cannabis Cup,